Hey, welcome back to our online Bible school, Concrete and Cranes. We are so glad you're here. You know, last time I was so excited to welcome you here, I forgot to introduce myself. I'm sorry about that. Around here at Concrete and Cranes, my name is Carl, C-A-R-L, not to be confused with Charlie. Charlie's my nephew. He works here too, and boy, can he make some construction projects really interesting. Anyway, welcome back to Concrete and Cranes. We're so glad you're here. Remember, our theme for this week is Jesus, our strong foundation. Can you say that with me? Let's say it together. Jesus, our strong foundation. And our memory verse is Philippians 1:6. And I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Hey, it's going to be a great time here, and we're so glad that you're here. Let's start off by singing our theme song, Concrete and Cranes. Did a great job singing the song and doing all the motions, you know, Concrete and Cranes, or as I like to call it sometimes, Concretes and Cranes. You know, I just say it that way sometimes. But anyway, Concrete and Cranes, that's our theme song for the entire summer. But we have a theme song for tonight as well, and that song is called Forgiveness. It talks about forgiveness. Now, what in the world is forgiveness? Have you ever had anybody do anything wrong to you? Maybe they hurt you somehow. Well, you know what? When all of us feel hurt sometimes, but you know, you can hang on to that, and every time you see that person that hurt you, you can be like, you hurt me, you hurt me. Or you can forgive the person. So what does that mean? That means saying, you know what, you hurt me and I'm still hurting, I'm still feeling it, but you know what, I'm not going to hold you responsible for that. I'm not going to keep that against you anymore. I'm going to let it go. See, that's what we're talking about when we're talking about forgiveness. And the greatest thing, and that's what this song is talking about, the greatest thing that we can experience is forgiveness from God, because the Bible says that all of us have done things that are wrong. We've thought bad things, we've said bad things, we've done bad things. All of us have done things that have disappointed God, the one who made us. But He offers forgiveness to us if we'll put our trust in His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's what this song is about. So let's all stand up and sing it. You can do the motions and sing along. It's going to be a lot of fun. I'm so thankful for all the effort you put into learning that new song. You did a great job. You know what else I'm thankful for? I'm thankful for forgiveness. Just imagine what life would be like without forgiveness. Just imagine this, like two friends, they get in a fight, they hurt one another, and then without forgiveness, it's like having a brick wall in between the two friends. You know, if there's never any forgiveness, that hurt just stays there. And then there's more hurt, and if there's no forgiveness, that hurt just gets bigger, and that wall just gets taller. And if there's more hurt without forgiveness, it just gets taller and gets taller. And before you know it, there's this big separation between you and your friend. See, that's the same way it was between us and God. The Bible says all of us were like God's enemies. We're separated from God because of our sin, because of all the things we've done wrong, just like we talked about a little while ago. But God sent His Son Jesus so that we could be forgiven, because He took the price for us, for our sins, on the cross. That is such good news. Hey, did you notice in the song there was a memory verse? There was a verse. It's not a memory verse, but it's a verse from the Bible that was featured in that song. It's Romans 5:8, which says, "But God proves His love towards us in this, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." So I'm so thankful for that, so that the wall between us and God can be broken down. Hey, speaking of walls and bricks and blocks and things like that, you might need some of these for a little bit later on during our missions time. You can either have some bricks or blocks, or you could have some cards, you know, some playing cards that you'd use in a game. Anything that you can stack, you might want to use that, have that around for a little bit later on. But hey, guess what? In just a minute, our story foreman's going to come, and he's going to share about a guy who had done a lot of things to hurt the cause of Christ and what God was doing, and yet Jesus encountered him and offered him forgiveness. So we'll find out about that when our story foreman comes right after we sing this song one more time. So let's stand up and sing it again. Forgiveness.
There's no way that we can earn it. There's no way that we promise, greater is the God who's in us. God proves his love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died upon the cross to bring us forgiveness. God proves his love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died upon the cross to bring us forgiveness. There's no way we can attain it. No other.
Hey, Charlie, that load of wood come in? You ordered toothpicks. We need bigger wood than toothpicks. You're going to have to send it back and get some 2x4s. Toothpicks. Who builds a building with toothpicks? I've never seen anything like it. Oh, hey, guys, how you doing? Well, I got the blueprint again, and we're ready for phase two of Vacation Bible School this week. I'm the story foreman, just in case you forgot, and I'm here to tell you some incredible stories about Jesus Christ and how much He loves you and what He's done for us. Now, today, I got a story that is just unbelievable. You know something? I want to tell you the story about a guy who wrote a big section of the New Testament. That's the second half of the Bible. And somebody that God used to honestly take the gospel to the whole world. You may know him. His name is Paul. You may have heard it in Sunday school or in different places, but I want to tell you the story about Paul. Now, Paul was going around telling people about Jesus, and people in one particular place didn't like him doing that. So they actually had Paul arrested. And so he got there and they threw him in jail and he sat there. And they figured if they left Paul in jail long enough, it would be a favor to the Jews and they would be okay and happy. Well, the governor of that particular area changed hands and a guy named Festus became the governor. Festus. Odd name, right? But anyway, so as Festus was the governor, it happened that one day Festus heard that the king, his name was Agrippa, was coming to visit him. And so he thought, hey, it'll be a good thing for me to tell him that I got Paul in jail. And so Agrippa had heard about Paul and he wanted to meet him. So they got Paul all cleaned up and guess what? They brought him before the king. Well, you know what Paul did, don't you? Do you? I bet you do. Paul saw standing before the king as an opportunity to tell him what Jesus had done in his life, to give his what's called a testimony of what God, how he came to know Jesus Christ. You know, if you know Jesus and you have a personal relationship with him, guess what? You have a testimony that you can share with other people, to share with them how Jesus came into your life, how you met him, how you trusted him, and what he's done in your life since then. So as we tell the story about Paul going before King Agrippa and telling his story, why don't you start thinking about your story with Jesus? And if you haven't started your story with Jesus yet, at the end of this story, I'm going to tell you how you can do that, okay? So here we are, big banquet hall, and there's the king sitting on this great big throne chair, and in comes Paul. And King Agrippa says, tell me about yourself. And so Paul tells his story. Paul starts off by saying, you know, I was a Pharisee. I was one of the religious leaders of my day. And I was so important. This is the interesting thing. Before Paul met Jesus, Paul was given arrest warrants. And what he did was he would go around and put Christians in chains and haul them back to Jerusalem for trial. Now, unfortunately, some of these Christians that Paul arrested, when they got back to Jerusalem and they were tried and went on trial, they died because they believed in Jesus Christ. And so they would go before the judge, and Paul would tell the judge all that they did as Christians and how guilty they were. And that judge would pronounce a sentence. Guilty! And they would be put in jail, and some were even put to death. You see, that was Paul's job before he came to know Jesus. Bad job, isn't it? Well, one day Paul was going on a road called the Damascus Road. He was on his way to Damascus to arrest some more Christians. And so as Paul was there, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, there came this really bright light. And it hit Paul. And it was so bright on Paul that it knocked him down to his feet, on his back. Oh no, my office has fallen apart. But anyway, we'll fix that later. I'll get Charlie in here. He'll bring some of those toothpicks and we'll put it back up, okay? Now, what happened was this light shone in Paul's eyes and it blinded him. And he couldn't see. And there was this bright light and he heard a voice saying, Paul, why are you persecuting me? And Paul said, who are you? And the voice said, I am Jesus. I am the one that you are persecuting. And you know, Paul, man, that bright light was there and he was blind. And the Bible says that after the voice stopped and the light went away, Paul, he couldn't see. And so they had to lead Paul to where they were going. And the Bible says that they took him to an inn and they let him sit there. They just left him sitting there blind. And during that time, Paul came to realize about Jesus. And so the Bible tells us, and Paul told Agrippa, he said, there was a man named Ananias. And God went to Ananias and he was a Christian. And he told Ananias, he said, have you heard of Paul? And Ananias said, yes, I have. He's the guy that arrests people and gets them sent to jail, Christians. Well, yeah, I've heard about him. He's not a nice guy. And God said, I got something for you to do. This man that you're talking about, I have chosen him to take the gospel to the rest of the world. And Ananias said, hey, God, that's great. You go right ahead and do that. And God said, but Ananias, I want you to go to Paul. And you're going to put your hands on him and he's going to regain his sight and you're going to tell him about me. And Ananias went, God, are you sure about this? Do you know about this guy? I mean, he arrests people and has them tried and thrown in jail. They're Christians. And guess what, God? I'm a Christian too. And he might arrest me and throw me in jail. And God said, no, you don't have to worry. Remember, I have told you that I have chosen him and that he is going to be someone very special. And so Ananias said, well, okay. So Ananias went down and sure enough, he found Paul sitting in a room. What else could he do? He was blind. And Ananias went in and he began to talk to Paul and he put his hands on Paul. And the Bible says he could see. And Ananias began to tell him about Jesus. And at that moment, Paul understood who Jesus was. and that Jesus had died on the cross for him. He had heard about that, but he thought Jesus was just a criminal. But at that moment, he knew Jesus was the Savior. And so he had this desire, and he prayed, and he asked Jesus into his life, and he trusted Jesus. And he said, "Lord, what do you want me to do?" And Paul looks at King Agrippa, and he said, "God has called me to take the gospel and the reality of Jesus Christ to the entire world." Now think about that. Going from a person who arrested and had people, Christians, put on trial, arrest them, throw them in jail, to go from that to being a Christian yourself and being the one that God was going to use to take the gospel to the world. Man, think about that. All the places that Paul went, all the places where he took the gospel, places Ephesus and Corinth and all of these places, a lot of those places, that part of the world knew Jesus Christ because of the churches that Paul started. You know why? You see, most of us would look and say, "But Paul, once again, arrested Christians and put them on trial and had them thrown in jail, some of them even killed." Certainly, God could have chosen someone better than Paul. But you know what? Last week we talked about God choosing to love us and that God truly loves everyone. Well, you know what? God loves us no matter what our sin is. We would look at Paul's sin and say, "Oh, that's terrible. He was a bad man. He doesn't deserve to do anything for God." But you know what? God came to Paul. And Paul gave his life to Jesus. And his sins, no matter how bad they were forgiven. And God had this wonderful plan for Paul's life. He had a, look. God had a blueprint for Paul's life, just like he's got one for yours. Now maybe you go, "Well, my sin's nothing like Paul's." That's right, but it's still sin. We all sin. The Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But it also says this. It says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God loves you. Jesus loves you. He's proven it through the cross. He has this plan for your life. And your sin is not going to stop God from loving you. And it's not going to stop God from saving you if you ask Him. God saved Paul. Once again, hey, let's show it one more time. A man who arrested Christians and sent him to jail. And God used him. God used him to bring the gospel to the whole world. Just think of what God can do for you and with you because He loves you, because He chooses to love you. Phase one, He chooses to love you. Secondly, phase two, God loves you in spite of your sin. Whatever it is, God can forgive it. There is no sin too great for the cross not to forgive. So if you haven't given your life to Christ, if you haven't trusted Jesus, now's a great time to do it. All we got to do is say, "Guess what, Lord? I'm a sinner. I do things wrong. I say bad things about my brother and sister. I disobey my parents. I lie. Lord, I've even stolen some things. Lord, forgive me for that." And He will. And all you got to do is say, "Lord, I need you in my life. I want to have a relationship with you. Please forgive me and come into my life." All you got to do is say that. And God will do that. Jesus will answer that prayer. And you can begin that wonderful journey your whole life of knowing God's blueprint for your life, okay? Remember, we're going to keep after it. Phase one, God chooses to love you. Phase two, guess what? God loves you no matter what your sin. You can come to Him right now because He loves you. You keep that in mind. Now, next time, phase three, hang on. It's going to be good. Until then, think about what we've talked about the last couple of weeks and tell Jesus Christ you love Him and thank Him for loving you, okay? Until then, I got to go get some toothpicks out and get some 2x4s in and tell Charlie he needs to pay better of attention, okay? We will see you next week. Love you. See you then.
We are so glad that you're joining us for missions here at VBS. And I hope you got your cards or blocks or something that you can build a house with. You can see there are all kinds of different things we can use to build these houses. They don't look like the houses that we live in right now. I don't think they would stand up too well or keep the rain out or help us cool with air conditioning, which we really need right now. So work on those houses. See how high you can get it in just another minute or so. Houses are very important to us, aren't they? That's the place where we've been spending most of our time these last few weeks, I hope. People live in different kinds of houses all over the world. Hopefully none of them are made out of blocks or cards like these. We're going to go today to another part of the world where houses were made not out of stuff like this, but they were easily destroyed. As you watch this video, notice how the houses had been destroyed and what was still wrong with them. Also look for wheels in the video. That's something we're going to ask you about afterwards. So let's go to the video and see how easily these houses were destroyed.
So most people know Puerto Rico as the Enchanted Island because it's gorgeous. It's just beautiful. But underneath that beauty, there's so many people that are broken. There's an estimated 33,000 families that are still living under blue tarps. And for us, it's not about the roof. It's about people under the roof. Puerto Rico does not get the same attention as it did months after Hurricane Maria. And that is why we're here, because we see the hopelessness, we see the lostness, and we know that the gospel is the only solution. So we look to the local church and we look to the pastors to assess those needs. We make sure that we have the materials and the volunteers to connect with that specific need, because ultimately we want every family that we serve to be connected to a local church. Our volunteers that come from Southern Baptist churches, they're selfless. They could choose to go somewhere else, but they choose to come back, and they choose to be here in Puerto Rico to serve these families that are still struggling. But the story doesn't end there. We cannot do this without people sacrificially giving. When you give, it allows us to not just to rebuild a roof, but it allows us to have an impact in the lives of people. That's what I'm seeing all over the island. And that's what I want the whole world to see.
I hope you were paying close attention during the video. Ms. Andrea mentioned something that you should be looking for, things with wheels. So, what did you see? Right, there was a car. Hopefully you noticed that. And there was also a bike, and there was somebody pushing a shopping cart. If you saw all three of those, great job. Now, there was a hurricane that hit this country. Do you remember what it was called? It was called Hurricane Maria. It hit almost 3 years ago, and people are still having problems because of it. One of the problems is that they're forced to live under a house with a certain thing as a roof. Do you remember what he mentioned? It was a blue tarp, like this one. Obviously not something you would want to be living under. Now, do you remember the number that he said for how many families were still living under one of these? 33,000. That's a lot of people. And he mentioned something that was their eventual goal, what they were trying to get done. Do you remember? It was connecting all the families to a local church. And also, one last thing. The volunteers were wearing a shirt with the same color. What was it? Light blue, right? All of these shirts had something very special written on them. They said, "Send relief." Now, Miss Andrea is going to tell us all about what that means.
Send relief. This is the Compassion Ministry of the North American Mission Board. This is a way that our churches have of providing help to people who need it. In North America, they also work around the world with the IMB. But Send Relief works with refugees who are settling into life in a new country. It also helps kids in foster care who may need some extra supplies, and they definitely need a lot of love. They help victims of fire or natural disasters, which is why Send Relief is working here in Puerto Rico, because they not only had the disaster of Hurricane Maria and all the effects of that, that even after 3 years they're still recovering from, but they've had other issues going on this year. In January, they had an earthquake hit the island that was a 6.4 magnitude. There were houses that were knocked off their foundations. I saw pictures online of where the houses were leaning so much that the homeowners had set up tents outside to sleep in their front yard because they were afraid to go back in their house. Not only did that earthquake hit, but they kept having aftershocks that were over 5 in magnitude, which means there was more damage being done. And people were afraid for their lives. So that was in January. And then what happened? Do you remember what's happened to us this year? COVID hit. So that means everything shut down. Kids were already out of school because of the earthquakes, but they didn't get to go back. Families didn't have a place to live. What did they need? They needed help. They needed relief. And that's where Send Relief came in. This was an opportunity for Christians to reach out and provide help replacing a roof, maybe provide a meal that was needed. In fact, in March in Puerto Rico, there were over 50,000 meals that local churches were able to distribute to the elderly, to people who were in poor health and couldn't get out, and to people who didn't have a paycheck because their jobs were lost because of the COVID crisis. Send Relief, a way to show God's love to others. And in this way, you're meeting a need. People are hungry. People need a good place to live. You're building a relationship, showing God's love to somebody so they can build the ultimate relationship, showing where Jesus showed how much he loves them. And then their life can be changed because Jesus is the one who transforms our lives. We want to send relief. How do we do that? Well, first of all, we pray. Do you remember in missions that our main job for VBS is praying? We're going to do that in just a moment. We'll talk about giving, and then we can go and send relief by showing God's love to other people. Our most important job for missions in VBS is praying. We want you to remember to do that all week for the people in Puerto Rico that we've just learned about. So let's make another prayer reminder like we did the prayer gear last time. What I want you to do is find a piece of paper. It doesn't have to be big. It doesn't have to be fancy. If it's blue, you get bonus points. Then you need something to write with. Pencil, crayon, marker. And again, if it's blue, more bonus points. On your paper, are you ready? I want you to write a capital P. And then a capital R. And what do you get? PR. What does that stand for?
I know. Power Rangers.
No.
It stands for pork rinds.
Not pork rinds.
Pancake recipe.
Purple ring.
Let's focus on the important things. It's a prayer reminder, and it's for Puerto Rico. PR. That should be a good reminder to you. If you got it on blue paper, that'll remind you of the blue tarps that the people in Puerto Rico, some of them are still living under after the hurricane. So, what are we going to pray for? Here we have some specific prayer requests. You can pray that Puerto Ricans will be filled with hope in Jesus instead of fear due to their circumstances. Jesus is the one who can give us all hope. We'll pray that families will connect with local churches in Puerto Rico. That way they'll have relationships with other Christians who can encourage them and help them to grow in Christ. Pray that Jonathan Santiago and the Send Relief team in Puerto Rico will introduce many people to Jesus. Remember, he's the one that they need a relationship with. Would somebody in your family like to pray? You can gather together. It doesn't have to be fancy words. God knows what our hearts are saying. So if one of you would like to pray, you can go ahead and do that. Lead your family. Come on, you big kids. I know you can do this. All lead us in prayer together here as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even though terrible things have happened in Puerto Rico, you are still in control, and you are still the one who can help us through all these disasters, that you are the one who can give us hope instead of fear. We pray that you will fill the Puerto Ricans with hope in Jesus. We pray that they won't be overcome by fear due to their circumstances. Lord, we also pray that the families will turn to local churches. They'll be connected with them and form relationships with believers there so they can encourage each other and grow in their relationship with you. Lord, we also pray for Jonathan Santiago and his team as they work with Send Relief. We pray that they'll be able to tell many people in Puerto Rico about Jesus and about the great hope that you give us. Thank you, Lord, that we can have that hope as well. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you for praying for missions with us. We want to make sure you also have the opportunity to give to missions, because that's one way we can be part of God's construction crew as His kingdom is being built here on earth. I hope you received the letter or have seen it online about our Coins for Construction that is our VBS offering this year. We're collecting money, can be coins, but we'll take cash too, or checks made out to the church with VBS offering on the memo line, for those of you who need those details. We will collect that money and send it to a tiny home community in Kentucky. In McCreary County, we're gonna go visit there next time, but we will be sending money to help them build this tiny home community where they can reach lives and change them with God's help. So Sunday, July 19th is a very important day. That's the day that we'll be collecting our VBS missions offering. You can bring your coins in that Sunday and put them in our special collection toolbox. If you can't make it that Sunday, you can just get it to the church office or put it in the regular offering. Just make sure it's designated VBS offering. As you bring your coins in, I want you to know there are so many opportunities for you to give. If you know of another need that your family would like to participate in meeting, don't feel like you have to do this VBS offering. Find someone where you can give them some help, give them hope, and show them the love of Jesus. So join us in giving to missions.
Hey kids, I'm so thankful for the important part that you're taking in praying for the people of Puerto Rico, praying for the people there, praying for the missionaries there who are sharing the love of Jesus so that those people can build their lives on the strong foundation of Jesus Christ. I know God's doing a work there because He loves those people so much, and I'm so thankful for your prayers for them. And I hope you'll keep praying. I hope you'll keep reminding your family when you pray together to pray for the people of Puerto Rico. Pray for the missionaries there. Now, we've got some more exciting things coming up tonight here at Concrete and Cranes before we finish up our time. We're going to sing a song or two. You know, I'm so excited and I'm so amazed at how quickly you're learning the words to these songs and all the motions. Like I said last time, before the end of the week, you'll be able to sing all these songs. You'll be singing them as you're going down the road, as you're walking through the house. It's going to be great. So we're going to enjoy a song or two together. And then after that, we're going to check in on that young architect, Renzo Wright, and see what's going on with him. So let's all stand up and let's enjoy these songs together.
Greater is the God who's in us.
day came, Renzo Wright, boy genius and youngest architect in the country, was chosen to make the largest building in the world. It was his first day on the job, and it's fair to say he was a little intimidated, which is just a fancy word for nervous.
Wow, it's a lot taller than I imagined it.
We need more blockos.
Renzo Tower, world's biggest building, coming soon. Pressure is on the boy genius.
I'm not worried at all. No problem.
The first skyscraper was built over 100 years ago and reached 10 stories tall. Today on this site, Renzo Wright shall build for Kitten Construction, Inc., the tallest and best building ever. Isn't that right, young man?
Yes, ma'am. I will build it perfectly.
He's going up to the clouds. Let's go again.
Lloyd.
With the opening ceremony over, it was time to meet the construction foreman, Mr. Santiago. Mr. Santiago believed in Renzo's plan completely.
Worst plans I've ever seen.
All due respect, Mr. Santiago, I spent the whole weekend making those.
Yeah, 170 stories, huh?
Can I drive the blue thingy?
Huh? Son, you should not operate anything out here.
It's 171 stories, actually. Check out the treehouse deck.
Look, kid, this is a heavy construction, cranes and concrete. Building a skyscraper means deadlines, hard work, and always following the rules. We've got a lot to do in a short time.
I know all this. I built lots of buildings.
With toy blocks, not real machines.
I'm not operating on it. I'm driving it.
Cease operation! Cease operation!
It's a bulldozer, but it seems wide awake.
Kid, get down from there! Get down from there!
Mr. Santiago? Allow me to demonstrate my serious skills.
Renzo, what are you doing?
Proving my work!
Oh! Lloyd, cease operations!
I'm digging for worms! Digging for worms!
No. Mr. Santiago, it isn't safe for you!
It isn't safe for me?
There really should be an age limit out here.
Stop this! Crazy thing!
Say, Mr. Santiago, where's the off button?
Oh, melted rainbow!
I suppose I should learn a few more things before I start giving orders.
Giving orders? Giving orders? Why, I... You ought to be given apologies.
If you want to make an omelet, you gotta break a few eggs, Mr. Santiago.
Omelet? Omelet?
Santiago, what are you doing making a mess out here? Embarrassing us in front of the genius kid. Go clean yourself up.
Nine.
Renzo, we have a problem.
Extra, extra! Cobra Cone Construction promises to build bigger, better, and faster than Boy Genius. Read all about it.
If you want to keep your special floor, you got to deliver bigger, faster, and better.
For the first time in his life, Renzo needed help. The truth is, Renzo really messed up, but he was not ready to admit it. Pride is a tricky thing. It causes all kinds of problems. Renzo had a lot to learn about asking for forgiveness. But fortunately, someone in his life was praying, and maybe it's not who you think.
Lord, please, help us forgive this boy. Give me patience with him. If we could survive him, that would be good too.